And you can always tell when there's a new group of people. You see, when my people come and I say, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, they all say,
good evening.
Well, when there's a new group. We're so glad that you're here. For anybody that I invited to come to dinner in the Vetsler Grill, I hope you didn't come because it's closed. I didn't. We're very, very grateful that you've come to participate in this second of our three-part series on civil conversations on constitutional matters. It's been a really interesting ride in terms of the planning and the presentation of the first session last week. Tonight's session will be exceptional, and I only say that so that you can come up to me at the end of the evening and say you were right. And I think you will grow from it, learn from it, share from it. It'll be wonderful. And it will set us up for next week, a week from tonight, next Thursday's third part of this program on the 14th Amendment and related issues, when we have an unstuck conversation. We hope that you will return and that you'll bring your friends so that we have a really nicely diverse group that is ready and prepared to talk and to listen. That'll be excellent. So that's next Thursday, 7 o'clock, back here in the Barrett Center. For those of you who are interested in the other programs of the Lifelong Learning Academy, we have this beautiful brochure. Everything that we do is beautiful here. Beautiful certificates, beautiful brochures. We have a number of activities coming up, especially now that we're moving into the month of April, since that's the last month of our school year. We have just a ton of stuff coming up. I would encourage you to consider coming to March 27th, which is a week, Wednesday, when Dr. Martin Horning, who is a professor emeritus from University of Mount Union, which we used to call Mount Union College. Of course, we used to call ourselves Walsh College, so I guess there's a chance. He's going to be giving a lecture on the program called On Pilgrimage with the Saints of the Americas. Dr. Horning is the kind of person who says, yes, I'll give the program. Then he works for months preparing the script and then calls me up and says, I need to come and have a rehearsal. All I can tell you is that he's the only person that's ever wanted to have a rehearsal. You'll enjoy his program very, very much. Then our big programs in April, we have three programs leading up to Holy Week, which will deal with the Passion, the Trial, the Saint, and the Cinema. How's that for a title? On April 2nd, which is a Tuesday, Dr. Chris Seaman is going to present a program on the trial of Jesus in a world of anti-Semitic violence. Fascinating topic. I will be there. I hope you'll join me. A week later, another one of our professors, Dr. Catherine Brown, Katie Brown, who is an art professor, has recently written a book, on Veronica, whom I keep calling Saint Veronica, but I think I'm wrong. I don't think she has officially been sainted yet. But maybe with the publication of this book, who knows? But she will present a book on Veronica and the Stations of the Cross. And then the final program in that series is going to be a program done by our priest in residence. That means he lives here. Father Michael Denk was going to do a program on suffering in the cinema. We're in the process of trying to get the movie clip so that we can use it to show you pieces of Gran Torino and Unbroken and some great films. You'll enjoy that. And those will be on one Tuesday and two Mondays during the month. Then just one last pitch. We're taking the Academy on the road again. We're going to go up to Parma to see the Shiva Vishnu temple and to learn a little bit about Hinduism, and then of course go out to eat because you got to eat. If you want to go, the date of the program is Saturday, April. That's not the program, that's me. Is Saturday, April 13th. We'll be leaving the parking lot in front of Our Lady of Perpetual Health Chapel at about 10 15 or 10:30. We'll go up for an hour at the Hindu temple and then go out to lunch. Hopefully to have a program during lunch about Hinduism at home, in case you want to do that. The program is free. Lunch is $13, a buffet. If you want van transportation, we have, I think, 8 seats left in the second van, and that'll be $25 a person round trip. But I will need your reservations for that. So you can reach me either at jspitzer@walsh.edu, or you can call me. The phone number's on the brochure. We have extra brochures here if you don't have one and would like one. Last pitch before we actually begin our evening. On your tables, you will find these cards. Lifelong Learning Academy cards. For those of you who have not seen them before, the Lifelong Learning Academy is Walsh University's effort to become an important value to the community through providing free education, adult education, each semester. Most of our programs, unless we're going by van or having lunch, really are free and open to the public. They are with our professors and invited guests, just like this evening. And if you want to be a part of the academy, there's no cost to it. Just fill out the cards each time you come. We'll keep track of your study with us, and we will recognize significant levels of participation. When you come here for 15 hours, we welcome you into the academy with a beautiful certificate. When you come for 30 hours, a better one. The first one was bronze. The second one is silver. See where I'm heading? At 45 hours, you get a certificate, and the color will be gold. We had a whole bunch of people who passed 45 hours, so we started the Vice President's Council, which we used to call the Provost Council until they got divided, and I think they're back to, I don't know what it is, but the Provost Council, and then we give you an even beautifuler certificate. This one doesn't come in a cardboard folder, it comes in a plastic frame. It's very nice. And we have a little swag that we give you with the logo of the Lifelong Learning Academy. And if you have been with us for 125 hours, think of what that is. Our lectures are about an hour and a half apiece, so 125 hours, about 75 visits to Walsh University, it's a lot of visits. 75 or so visits, we welcome you into the President's Cabinet. Now, I will tell you that we had some issues with our Excel program and how the hours were added. And so we have not yet awarded the President's Cabinet certificates and swag for last semester. I know this because Lou back there has his publicist, that's his wife, who said, you know, you haven't recognized us. Well, we got a number of people who have crossed that really high mark, and I think probably at the end of the semester, when I do my last program on ethical wills, we will give out those awards. We really appreciate people who support the program that way. So that having been said, we're going to do two things now. Thing number one is that I'm going to call upon Dr. Larry Bowe, who, for a philosopher, is nonetheless the patron saint of these programs. Dr. Bowe has come upon a beautiful meditation on social justice and racial justice, which he'll share with us as a meditation to begin. While he is walking up to the front to do that, I will walk to the back and hopefully be able to start the video camera. Good luck. And then when he's finished, I will say, Andre Lessears, I hope you please push the pause button on the
digital recorder.
Any questions? I didn't think so.
Welcome everyone here today on the Day of Salvation. I helped you. Behold now is a very acceptable time. Behold now is the Day of Salvation. This is from St. Paul's Epistle to the Corinthians. Welcome to our Lenten journey, she says. This year, we invite you to join us as we dive into the challenging truth of racism in our society and the continuing saga of white privilege. We at Network have been grappling with this reality for years. In the process, we have examined the structural racism in our laws, those often unseen structures that keep us bound in social sin through the racial wealth and income gap, health disparities, and more. Our study has led us to see that our societal structures are woven together with the vestiges of slavery and prejudice, and the continued modern structures of racism even today. But even more challenging are the many ways that we benefit as a white person in our racist society. As a staff, we have been reading the book White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. She points out one aspect of white privilege is that we white folks can avoid talking about race. We find it painful and sometimes embarrassing to do so. White folks have the luxury to avoid the conversation. I realize that we do this even here. I worry that we might say something insensitive. I'm personally embarrassed, she says, and I can change the subject. In addition to avoidance, individualism, DiAngelo posits this is at the heart of society's inability to move beyond anecdotal experience and make real systemic and personal change. We white people do not see the structures that secure our privilege and cement racial divides. So we thought that the best topic for our Lenten reflection is the issue of structural racism and privilege in these very challenging times. Doing this work requires us to embrace our roles as ambassadors of the divine and work together to rid ourselves of the social sin of racism. This is a communal need. If we build awareness of the societal dimension of this sin, then we can work together to dismantle the structural sin of racism. It won't be easy. It will require many of us to awaken to the ways that we, white people, unwittingly benefit from racism and still be willing to change. So let us spend this Lent together in an exploration of structural racism in our time. St. Paul is correct when he writes in the second letter to the Corinthians, "Behold, now is a very acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." Thank you, Sister Simone Campbell. Again, there's 7 or 8 pages left. If you're interested, she gives meditations for white people, meditations for people of color. She goes on to another levels about dealing with the topic. Their feeling is that Lent is an appropriate time to try to peel back the structural divides that invisibly keep us separated. So I hope, in that interest that tonight, we're glad to welcome Andre Lessears, who is a Walsh member of the Walsh community, a student, colleague, and now working for Cleveland Clinic, to talk about something that we all share, and we all share this implicit bias, things that help us keep us away from things that upset us. So I hope you learn a lot about that today, and we're going to build on that next week, and we're going to have some discussions about our interracial dialogue, about different things that divide us next week. So thank you.
Thank you. So good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Awesome. So I just have to lay some ground rules, okay? This is really going to be more of a shared experience. My job is to keep us on track as we have a very intentional conversation. You're going to have some conversations with various people in the room. Most of the time, you're going to be talking to the people at your table. But inevitably, what we want to do is create a safe space where we can really unpack this thing called implicit bias. The reality of it is that we all have bias. Can we agree with that? Yes. Right? For the sake of this conversation, we have to operate under the premise that bias in and of itself is neither good nor bad. Okay? Bias in and of itself is simply how we have learned to navigate the world. And I'll give you an example. How many of you can think of your favorite color? Did it pop in your head almost before I finished the sentence? Yeah? Your favorite ice cream? No, that's hard. Tough. It's like trying to pick your favorite child, right? But most of us have a favorite ice cream. We have a bias towards a certain ice cream. We have a bias towards a certain color, right? Here's how it takes the next step. When I ask you, describe a firefighter, what's the first image that comes to mind? Man, a hat, someone said man. Man, about yay tall, youngish, yeah. That's usually when I stop the conversation, because it goes like downhill. Because they don't describe the firefighters that I'm used to seeing, which are not always young or in shape. Or is, you follow me? When I ask you to describe a nurse, what's the first image that comes to mind? White hat, female, right? Are there female firefighters?
Yes.
Are there male nurses?
Yes.
Why is it that we don't think of them when we say firefighter or nurse?
Where was when we were young?
Socialized bias. Right? It's socialized. We play a role into it. I like to watch movies, right? This is not a very appropriate movie or a very good movie at that, but there's a movie with Adam Sandler, forget his name, but it's called Meet the Fockers. Anybody seen it before? Yeah. Funny movie. Not very good, but funny nonetheless, right? He is a male nurse. Robert De Niro's character asks him, why didn't you just be a doctor? You're gonna go to school for that long, why didn't you just become a doctor? You see how we play into that? How many of you are moms in the room? If your daughter came to you and said, Mom, I want to be a plumber, would it create a pause for you? For any of you? Some of us, yes. Dads, yes, maybe. We'd have a serious conversation and it'd go something like this. Sweetie, are you sure you want to be a plumber? There's so many things that you can do, but are you sure? You see how we play into that? Plumbers make really good money, right? But somehow or another, we self-select ourselves into certain roles, right? That's socialized bias. Does that make sense? And so that's what we're going to unpack, is how do we create intentional space to pause and check those biases that we all fall victim to? Because we all do, right? We're going to talk a little bit about how our brain works in making sense of those things. Because here's the reality of it. As evolved as we've become as people, our brain still only works well most of the time. Does that make sense? We're walking around with computers in our pockets. We have access to more information at our fingertips than any other generations in the history of human existence. But yet our brain can only handle so many bits of information. As a result of that, what tends to happen is we create shortcuts to make decisions. Where do you think those shortcuts get their information? Our lived experience. Does that make sense? Our lived experience is limited. Right? It's very limited. And as a result of that, we only make decisions that are well enough, and we hope they have the best results. Does that make sense? So that's how we're going to frame this conversation. Here are some things that I'm going to ask you to do that I know are difficult in day-to-day life. Okay? I'm going to ask you to assume good intent. For particularly for people who belong to marginalized groups, people of color, religious marginalized groups, sexual orientation, etc. We're not going to go there. But the assumption of good intent is difficult to do when you know or have experienced things that prove otherwise. Does that make sense? But for this conversation, we're going to create a safe space where we can assume good intent. We're going to unpack how we can get there so that we can work on the other things to mitigate some of the bias that plays. All right? But that's one ground rule that I think we really need to focus on, is the assumption of good intent. Because I'm going to have you have some conversations where someone may say something to you that causes you to want to, as my grandma say, drop kick them. Does that make sense? And you're going to ask them, you're going to have to create a safe, I want to create a safe space where you can create a moment where you can say more about that. Give me a little bit, and I'll help you, I'll unpack a little bit about how and why that's an important question we need to start to learn to ask. How do we create that intentional space where instead of assuming bad intent, we create a pause and we ask the person, say more about that. Okay? Are we good? Okay, so I'm going to move around the room a little bit. I was raised by a Baptist preacher, although I'm not a Baptist preacher. There's already a minister of Lessears in the family. There doesn't need to be two. But I'm going to move around, okay? I'm going to ask you to move around as well if you are able. All right? The other thing is there's always choice. If I ask you to do something, if I ask you to have a conversation and you don't feel comfortable, you don't have to participate. You have choice. Okay? You might need to raise your hand if you need to take care of the facilities. You're adults for the most part. Police yourselves. Any questions before I get started? No? Okay. So, I have been doing, I like to kind of get us moving a little bit, and I'm going to share a video that I think really captures how we often approach conversations around difference. So, I do have to tell you all this. So, I don't use buzzwords, so I don't use diversity hardly at all. I do talk about race. But only in the appropriate context. So if you hear me say things like navigate difference, work across difference, managing or navigating gray, that's what I mean. I mean navigating diversity, race, etc., so forth. Okay? I define diversity as any difference that makes a difference, period. Right? Because there's something called intersectionality. Right? It means that we are not just one thing. Okay? And we're going to unpack that a little bit. But the reality of it is, if I only talk about race, which is real, the issues are real, I am eliminating a whole lot of other things that factor into how we experience each other. Not interact with each other, experience each other. Intersectionality is real. And unfortunately, it goes unseen and untalked about. But in reality of it is, that's often, there's a lot of other things playing a role, and race just happens to be the hot ticket that we put things onto. When in reality, it's maybe race and a whole lot of other things. Right? Okay? So when I say talk about difference, that's me. So don't think I'm trying to avoid the diversity word or race or anything like that. It's just more authentic for me to talk about how we can navigate difference. Okay? Are we cool? Okay. All right, so here's a great video that I think really shows how we often experience navigating difference.
Take a step. Right?
And then when that person who we, so typically that person we wait to fix it is a consultant. We love consultants, right? Or a trainer, you know, some tall, dark, and handsome guy, you know, with a nice smile to tell us what we should do, right? And then what? They come, they get us all excited, and then what happens? Thank you for the money, good luck. Right? And often what they do is they tell us what we already know. But they don't really offer any solutions. Right? They're not around to do the work. And so I don't have anything against consultants. Hey, more power to you. But the reality of it is that the conversations that we really need to navigate, is they're not that difficult. They're difficult because we have been socialized to believe that they have to be comfortable conversations. That I have to, if I like you, I have to agree with you 100%. But that's not real. I've been married for 15 years, and trust me, I love my wife, but I don't agree with everything she says. I know she doesn't agree with everything I say. She reminds me regularly. Right? Okay? But those are uncomfortable conversations, but we can unpack them and we can navigate them. We just have to create space. Nothing happens by accident. Nothing happens by accident. Any solution has to be addressed with intentionality. And being intentional means we have to create authentic space that is truly safe. Where someone that I love or know or at least like a little bit can say something to me and it doesn't fit my context and I instantly dismiss them as not getting it. Or worse, not caring. Because their experience is not my experience, and what they're saying doesn't fit into my context of how I experience the world. And because those things don't fit, I can't have a conversation with this person. But we all work with other people, right? Who fit that description, who do things differently, who you look at and say, how did they get hired? You probably said that today. Some of us, right? But yet, they surprise us every now and again. They actually figure out what they know, what they want to do. Okay? And so today, what I want us to do is I want us to investigate and ask questions. The number one skill to navigate difference successfully is self-awareness. Self-awareness. The next skill is curiosity. These are learned behaviors. Does that make sense? The ability to navigate difference is a learned behavior. None of us are born with the ability to navigate difference successfully. It does not come natural. I've been black for 39 years. Come tomorrow. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Right? This is all I know. Okay? Just because I happen to have this awesome permanent tan for the last 39 years does not mean that I deal with difference any better than any of you who have to work at your tan. Does that make sense? Some of you caught that. She got it. Right? Now, I may have a different perspective, and in America, I may have a little leg up as far as the impact of my difference, but it doesn't mean that I have a monopoly on, or I'm some default expert. It just means that I may have a little head start on the impact of how that impacts me, right? So I want us to learn, how do we ask questions? Not necessarily about someone else's experience, but our own experience. Does that make sense? Okay, I'm going to do something real quick. So for those of you who can or are able, stand up. Find someone that you are next to. And I want you to stand about arm's length away from it and just talk about the weather. That sense of personal space, it just popped up one day. Someone was in, was close to you, or depending on how close they were, you were like, I don't like where they are. And depending on how you grew up, that space is a lot smaller than others. Right? But why? How many of us have ever become curious as to why is it that my personal space is this area and others are this area? Does that make sense? No one's ever, we've conditioned ourselves. I love watching people do that activity because people tend not to get hits, right? I have very small personal space, so I have to watch myself. When I see someone, I'm talking to them, and I walk up to them and I greet them, my natural inclination is to bring them close to me. But I tend to get the stiff arm, right? And then they stand like this. And then when I get closer, they tend to do this. And if I'm really not picking up the hint, they do this. Does that make sense? I know that about myself. I am now aware of that. But before I became self-aware, I thought, well, I just need to get close to this person. Something's wrong. I just, okay. You keep stepping, I can keep stepping too. You follow me? And then people start assuming, it's like, oh, what's wrong with this dude? He's like, he's in my space. He's really, that's the nice interpretation of it. That's why self-awareness is so important. Because we may be saying things, doing things, behaving in certain ways that we're not even aware of. And we need to be curious as to why and how they're impacting the people around us. Okay? I want you to actively participate, and we're going to try to really do some fun stuff. So here's the next act. Here are some key definitions. I've already said this stuff. We don't judge our bias. We just go about doing it. Think of it more like autopilot. Okay? When you're just simply doing and not thinking. Here's an example. I want everyone to close their eyes, visualize your commute from your house to your job.
I'm retired.
Or if you're retired, what route you used to take. Right?
I love those. Imagination.
How much thought do you actually put into that commute? Yeah. How much thought did you actually put into your commute? Or just think of any place you go regularly. Coffee shop, church, etc. Anywhere that's just routine. How much thought do you put into that commute?
None.
Now, unless there's a detour or an accident, how much thought do you actually put into those routes? You want to keep yourself sharp, right?
Exactly.
Okay. But most of us, we put very little thought into it. Are there other things we do that we just simply, we don't put much, any thought into them at all? We just do. Naps. Oh, I wish. That's what bias is. It's our autopilot. It's worked for however long you've been on this earth. It's always worked. It's never let you down. So you don't even put any thought to it. That's when people who are making hiring decisions say things like, it's just my gut. Right? Well, your gut, then, that's not really your gut. It's just your experiences. And you say it's your gut. But our experiences are limited. Right? All right, talk about diversity. Inclusion is just simply intentionally leveraging difference. Okay? Intentionally leveraging. Okay, so I want you to do a little activity. Okay? I want you to write down 5 core cultural identifiers that describe yourself. Okay? There's post-it notes at your table. Just five. So things that you would say, these five things are at my core, the core things that identify me. I'll use myself as an example. I am a father. I am African American. I prefer black because of my generations. I'm a little far removed to claim Africa, but I am a black American, okay? I've been married for 15 years, okay? I am an older sibling. I'm the oldest of five, okay? And I am a Christian. Those are five things, okay? So what are five core things that you would say, this is me? Without these five things, this really, I really wouldn't be me. Or here are five things that others might perceive who I am. Okay? They could be around race, gender, sexual orientation, religion, whatever. Five core things. Okay, how many of you have your five? How many of you are struggling to come up with five? Anybody have a hard time? Yeah? Why do you think you're having a hard time coming up with five? How many of you are trying to limit it to five?
I just did everything.
I have to ask, because there are always a few. Like, I'm awesome. Only five? Right? How many of you are having a hard time just coming up with five? Like, you have two or three, but those last four, fourth and fifth ones are hard for you to be struggling. Yeah? How often do you actually think about who you actually are? What actually impacts how you have arrived at where you are today? Right? Carly Ever. Right? But there are five core things about you, right? So I need five. Right? Okay. You have to come up with five. Do some low-hanging fruit ones, you know. I don't want personality types. I don't want stingy or friendly or nice or friendly. I don't want those. If you're having a hard time, think about how would other people label you? Okay, so for the sake of time, we're going to have to move on. I need you to cross off two.
Cross off two.
Cross off two. Just cross off two. Any two you want. Was that hard for anyone to cross off two? Yeah? Some of us? Are you still negotiating? Are you crossed off one? Are you rebelling?
Think about who I am every day and what I want to be and what I am want to do to help the world.
Okay.
And a lot of these things on here, I'm that's the way this who I am.
I just need you to cross them up. I'm not saying you can't be those. I just need you to cross them up. I know it's hard. There's no right or wrong. You got your two?
I got one.
You got one. Okay, we're going to move on. I need you to cross off two more. You should have one thing left. Just one. You should have one thing left. This is where some of you are starting not to like me.
Never.
Yeah. Okay. So here's what I'm going to do. I want to go around the room, and I just want you to share your one thing you have left. I don't need it. Don't explain it. Just name it. That's it. It should be really, really quick. Just name it. Don't explain it. Name it. Okay? We're going to start over here.
Educated.
Twin. Mother of two. Christian. White.
Child of God.
Child of God.
African-American.
Grandma Black. I was reading her shirt, not calling her. What was your last thing? You have on your list. Are you still negotiating? Okay. Come back to you.
Father.
Follower of Jesus Christ.
Follower of Jesus Christ.
Christian.
Religious.
Catholic.
Italian American.
Father.
Person.
White woman.
Black.
Brown.
Christian.
Male.
College graduate.
Female.
Christian.
Short.
God.
Christian.
Singer.
Family member.
Female.
Christian.
Military.
Wife.
Okay.
Familial role.
Got it.
First generation American.
Person of integrity.
Person of integrity. And at the back. Last thing.
Grandma.
African American.
Jew.
Did I miss anyone?
You.
Well, I am me. So here's some interesting things.
Are you going to Catholic schools?
Research
public school. Look at those Catholic school kids.
That in this given moment, that one thing you named, is most top of mind for you, and often is the thing you derive the most stress around. Not bad stress like, oh my God, what was me? But just stress, like it's top of mind in this moment. It's also the thing that you derive the most strength from. Right? So even though it may be top of mind and this has a lot of stress, like it's, that's something that may be worrisome, but it's also when the chips are down, that's your... Tony Dungeon has this thing as far as like what's in your well. That's kind of at your well. That's what's going to come up now, right? So we heard all the things that were mentioned, but what about the things that were not mentioned? Most of you, I didn't hear age, right? I didn't hear whether you were able-bodied or not. I didn't hear heterosexual, right? I didn't hear those things. So some of you are curious, like, wow, I wonder what this person is going to say. My inclination is often to figure out what's not mentioned. What was on your list that you either crossed out or that was on your list? It probably was the last thing, but you didn't choose the name. Oftentimes, we filter those things because we take on or we share the thing that we feel is the least threatening or what we feel like the majority of the group doesn't need to ask about, where we fit in the most. I have two cops. Someone said college educated. You said educated as well, right? That's typically not shared. And the real question is why? Dr. Bove mentioned in this Lenten message about how privilege, particularly white privilege, this activity really reveals how the privileges that the room assumes on what we don't share. Think about those of us who didn't have to think about whether there would be stairs or a ramp or an elevator to get here. that make sense? That's a privilege. Right? But we didn't, and we know it's a privilege because the majority of us didn't even think about it. And some of you are thinking like, wow, why didn't I think about that? Because it doesn't impact you. Does that make sense? We don't think about the things that impact, that don't impact us. That's why these conversations are difficult. Because if it's not me, I know me. I know my experience. And that's often the lens that we talk about. Any questions so far? Okay. I'm trying to move quick. Okay. So I'm going to skip this. So I want you to describe this picture. I want you to be as detailed as possible. There's, again, I want everyone at the table, take your pens, there's notepad, there's one clean sheet in the middle of the page, but I want you to describe the picture, okay? I'm gonna give you a couple minutes to do it. Be as detailed as possible, don't self-edit. Okay, if you think that's something, write it down. You can write it on your post-it note or the large white piece of paper. Yes?
Individually,
and then as a group, we're going to come up with one list. So for the next 90 seconds, I want you to write down as many descriptions of this photo as you can individually. Be as detailed as possible. Don't leave anything unturned. After you feel like you have a good start to your list, you can start creating one for your table. You can join the table with you.
Okay.
Creating one list at your table. You can. It doesn't mean you have to stop. On a big sheet of paper.
Thank you.
because once you get started, you're like, no, it's this. Right? Okay, I need three things from each group. Right? Now, here's the trick. If someone shares what you were going to share, guess what? You're going to have to share something else. Okay, we're not going to tally how many times a description is shared. Okay? So we're going to start over here. Three things. And Tiffany's going to record for me.
We see a dog.
Okay.
And we see all people have short hair.
All people have short hair. Okay.
And we see that there is a picture on the wall.
There's a dog, short hair for everyone in the group, and there's a picture. Okay, so you're referring to what that square thing on top of that person's head. Okay, got it. All right, we'll get there. Right here.
Okay.
We have a loving family. Multiple generational. A teenager standing up.
And then two smaller
children. Okay, and two small children. Got it. Okay, right here. We got three. Black family. There's a rug. And no TV. Got it. Three things. Living room.
Love.
And togetherness. Cute. Thank you. Three things. African family. Loving dog. Traditional family. Okay. Three things. 1950s. I love the period pieces. What else? Child hugging father.
Not the U.S.
Okay. Got it. Three things. Distant teenagers. Is there anything that's not distant about teenagers? Okay.
The scene is casual?
Casual scene.
And the son seems affectionate to his dad.
We have hugging dad, son hugging dad. We got the dog. The dog has been mentioned several times. All right, we'll come back. We're good.
Well, right. We only have two that haven't been mentioned.
Okay, two that's not mentioned.
There's no radio.
No radio.
And there's a woman, the only one with a decorative outfit.
Woman with decorative outfit.
And she has.
Oh, the person with no shoes. The guy has no. Yeah,
it's not big feet.
Okay, you're right. The woman has a bandana, and her head is probably grandma.
Okay, we have a grandma with bandana. Dad has big feet. I heard. Okay. All right, so what were my instructions? Describe the picture. Okay, so we're going to talk about what descriptions are and what the differences are. A description is just simply an objective description, right? It's what I see. An interpretation is what I think I see. Right? An evaluation is how I feel about what it is I think I see. Okay? A description is just simply an objective analysis. Here's what I see. An interpretation is subjective analysis. What I think I see. An evaluation is a value judgment. How I feel about what I think I see. Okay? The instructions are really simple. Describe the picture. We already know what the description is, right? An objective analysis. Okay? So we're going to see how well you describe the picture. I'm going to ask you, of all the things you shared, whether it's a description, interpretation, or evaluation. Okay? Are we clear? Dog. Okay, I'll give you that. Yeah. Some people call this an emaciated cat. Or malnourished cat. Right? Okay, but we got dog. I'll give you a description. Okay. Short hair. That's a description, yeah. Depends on what the person who has the hair dress on, what she has underneath there, but I'll give you that. Okay. We have a picture on the wall. Does everybody agree that's a picture? Some say window. Yes. I would say that's more of an interpretation. Okay. So, a loving family. Do you have some feelings about that? That's an evaluation. Okay. What do we have there? Multi-generational family. That's an interpretation. Do we know for sure that they're a family? Do you, some of you get that? All the cues are telling us they're family, but we're just interpreting that based on what we're assuming, people in a room who are close to each other, touching, etc., right? So interpretation, okay. Teen standing in the distance. Well, we don't know the age of that person. We're just interpreting that, right? Okay, what else? Two small children. I'll give you a description. We won't miss there. Black family.
Interpretation.
Do we know that they're black?
No.
It's interpretation. All right. So simple that I might. Okay. A rug.
This is a bad word.
We have a rug. Yeah. I don't know if this is a rug. Yeah. It could be a dirt floor. So that's an interpretation. No TV. Description. What else? Living room. Well, we don't know if they're in a house or not. That's an interpretation. We have love. That's an evaluation. We have togetherness. That's an evaluation. Because there's some feeling there, right? Okay. African family. That's an interpretation. Loving dog, that's an evaluation. Traditional family. I think that's more of an evaluation. Right? 1950s, well, that's an interpretation. Child hugging father.
What's the interpretation?
Do we know if that's his father? Or even if that's a man? That's an interpretation. Someone said not U.S. We don't know. That's an interpretation. Distant teen. That's an interpretation. I was going to say evaluation, but yeah, we'll figure that. Casual scene. That's an interpretation. No radio. Description. Woman decorate, or spots here. I'll give you a description. I gotta give you at least a few. Dad has big feet. So we have roughly, grandma and banana. Well, we don't know if the age of this person, so that's more of an interpretation. The instructions were to what? How well did we do? You did no different than any other group. Because here's the reality. Our brains are meaning-making machines. We get from description to interpretation in a millisecond. We are interpreting most of our experiences. Very rarely do we actually pause to actually describe what we're seeing. We share our interpretations and we falsely say that they're descriptions. The description for this picture is a black and white photo. There are multiple individuals in this picture of varying ages, various genders. You see how that works? That's a description. Some of you were telling this is a loving family. It's Father's Day. Dad is having a great meal. They just finished dinner. They're all telling us, Dad's telling a story. I'm not making this up. I've heard everything that this is a prison visitation day. This is visitation day at a prison. I've heard that, again, this is a emaciated cat or dog or deer. I've heard a deer. Someone that this is a roll of toilet paper. Yeah. That it is a lesbian family. That this is an abusive relationship with subservient women. That this is a bigamist with multiple wives. This woman is subservient to this man. Some of you are like, what? How did they get that? But seriously, do you see how quickly it's a break? And those things didn't happen by accident. The people who said that this was a lesbian couple, guess what? They were lesbians. The people who said that this was a visitation at prison happened to just go on a visitation day to visit someone in prison. I did this one time in June, a week after Father's Day. Do you see how that works? Our experiences frame our perspective, right? Usually military people get this done really well. Police officers get this done really well. Because they're trained, subject was approximately such and such height, such and such weight. The subject was such and such. You see how that works? But that's because they were trained. Most of us aren't trained like that. You see how that works? Can you see how that could impact how we have conversations around difference? If I'm operating from a lens that's different than yours and I'm not creating intentional space for us to actually have a conversation, and I say, that was racist, and then I say, no, it's not. End of conversation. Instead of, that was racist, or what you said was racist, say more about that. Not debating whether it was true or not, or whether you agree or not, but just curious on what it was that caused that person to feel or interpret that behavior or action or work or whatever as racist. But we instantly get to, no, it's not. Yes, it was. No, it's not. Yes, it was. I'm done with you. Well, I'm done with you. You're racist. Does that make sense? Do you see how that works? It's real quick. And some of us didn't even realize what we're doing. Did we? Some of you are like, man, I'm describing the heck out of this picture. Right? Okay. So there are many aspects of bias, but they really boil down to two basic categories: warmth and competence. When we come in contact with someone, Amy Cuddy, Susan Fisk, and Peter Glick from Harvard and Lawrence Universities did a research on how we categorize, or ultimately what informs us, or what informs our bias towards people or groups. And it was basically these categories. We interpret how warm, or the intentions of the person or group towards us, you know, that stranger danger, and their competence. Can they do what I'm interpreting or believe that they want to do? Does that make sense? Warmth and competence. And it happens instantly. Okay? So I want you all to take another piece of notebook, post-it paper, and write this, create this chart. Two columns, warmth and competence, and then numbers 1 through 7 up on the third column. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to show you a series of photos, and you're going to rate them 1 through 5, 1 being the least warm and least competent, 5 being the most warm, most competent. Okay? I'm going to show you 7 pictures. If you recognize anybody, don't say anything. If you know someone, don't say anything. I doubt you'll know someone, but you may recognize them. Okay? Warmth and competence. We're just going to rate it. All right, here we go. I want you to pay attention. What information are you gathering from the photos to help you determine how warm and how competent they are? Here's what I'm not going to do. 1, I'm not going to answer any questions about the pictures. 2, I am not going to show them more than about 4 seconds. Okay? And the reason being, we do this every day. How many of you go to the mall and like a people watch? Airport, people watch. Bus station. Yeah? How many of you create narratives about people that you come in contact with every day? We're great storytellers. Right? My favorite is when I see someone whose children are not behaving how I would think my kids will behave in public. We like that, right? Okay. Any questions before we get started? Because I'm not answering while I'm showing.
What
did you say the rating was? 1 through 5. 1 being the least warm and least competent. 5 being the most warm, most competent. I'm going to show you 7 pictures, so it's 1 through 7. Okay? Yes?
So do we rate the warm and competent?
Yes, you're rating both. Warm and competence. Okay? Here we go. How warm, how competent? 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 Okay. Y'all good? All right, so what did you notice you were gravitating towards to help you with your ratings?
Kind smiles.
Say it again.
How they were dressed.
How they were dressed, yes. What else?
Don't mess with me.
Don't mess with me. Posture, so their body posture. Yeah. What else? Have to sign all the...
The way they look at it, he says a professional or non-professional.
Yeah, so if it was a professional photo or not, right? Or if they were dressed professional or not. If they looked familiar, yeah? Some of you may have said, oh, that person reminds me of my neighbor, my uncle, my friend, my grandma, my dad, my et cetera. You know, that familiarity, right?
The Miss whatever she is,
yeah.
I really couldn't tell, but because she'd been in the competition, she seemed more confident.
Okay.
More.
So your experience of what she was doing. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to see how well you did. So this is all the things. The research by Dr. Cuddy basically said these are the things that we use to inform us on how warm or how competent someone is. These are all external, right? So let's see how well you did. Oh, sorry. So how many of you gave this person a 4 or better in warmth? One person. Thank you. A 4 or better incompetence. You don't know what he wants, what he does, but you know he can do it if he wants to. Right? Okay. This is John Fetterman. He's the mayor of Braddock, Pennsylvania. Actually, he's a U.S. representative now, I think. He's a master's in public policy from Harvard. He served in the mayor court. He has international attention for almost single-handedly revitalizing Western Pennsylvania. 4 or better in warmth. I call this the grandma effect. Yeah? Most of you, if you didn't think of it explicitly, you're like, wow, she reminds me of my grandma. And all grandmas are nice. Most grandmas are nice. 4 or 5 incompetence. With age comes wisdom. This is Preeta Patel. She's an economist attorney, and she's the first female president of India. She left office, however, because she liked to take her grandchildren on state-sponsored trips to Disneyland and Disney World and give them bonuses or allowances. She was supposed to. Yeah. Four or five and warmth. Don't be shy. 4 or 5 incompetence. You don't know who it is. Okay. Ted Bundy. Innocent, harmless guy, a law student. He wore a tweed jacket and drove a Volkswagen Beetle. Right? Harmless. That was his hook. You know, there's this great TED talk about how we smile with our eyes, right? You see those crow's feet?
Yes.
It gives the illusion of an authentic smile. There's another TED talk I want you guys, I can't remember who the person is by, but it's a young woman, it's titled, How to Spot a Liar. Okay. And it talks about how we give off cues and how to pay attention to those cues, right? Okay. 4 or 5 in war? Yeah? 4 or 5 incompetence? Yeah? Okay. Babe Jameson, physician, professor, U.S. astronaut. Any Trekkies in the room? Any Star Trekkies? She's the first astronaut, I think, right now, the only astronaut to actually appear real on the Star Trek series. That's the thing, I just had to let my geek flag. Alright, 4 or 5 in war? 4 or 5 incompetence. So, I hear it. And I don't know about this guy. Jameson, author, speaker, advocate. Born female, recognized expert in healthcare. Four or five or more? Some of you are like, no way. Four or five incompetents? Nope. Someone's like, absolutely not. This is Carla Mocha. She is a Canadian serial killer. Right? So she. As a bad Facebook profile picture. Right? Or sometimes some young ladies will mention, I wouldn't trust my boyfriend around. I don't go any further in that conversation. Four or five or more? Okay, she looks cold. Four or five incompetence. Interesting. This is Oksana Fedorova. She's Miss Universe 2002, who's had a PhD in civil law. So here's how we have, again, remember I talked about socialized bias earlier. When we think of beauty pageant contestants, do we think of? Socialized bias. They are scholarship competitions. They are. He's giving me the wink like. They actually are scholarship competitions, but because we have been socialized to think otherwise, because some of us are thinking, why do we need a bikini contest and a scholarship competition. Right? And why aren't men in it? Right? Socialized bias. And we are all guilty of it. I did this for some of our physicians, and a young lady physician, or a woman, she said, if I could give her lower than a one, I would. I was like, wow, that's deep. And another gentleman, a male physician, said, you know, absolutely, I give her fives across the board. And of course, everyone in the room was like, of course, you're going to give her fives. But he asked, so, you know, I'm curious. He said, why? He said, my daughter put herself through undergrad, graduate, and two graduate degrees doing beauty contests. So when he saw this, he saw his daughter. The woman physician, her husband left her for the beauty contest. Do you see how our experience frames our perspective? And again, this, I know that some of you may be thinking, like, what does this have to do with, like, racial injustice or racial equality and how we have those conversations? It has everything to do with those conversations because we're entering into most of those conversations from our own lens. And we say, I'll hear what they have to say. Or I think I know what I want to talk about. But the reality of it is, the moment we get emotionally triggered, which tends to happen in those conversations, our brain instantly kicks into fight or flight, which triggers autopilot. Which means, and when you're an autopilot, it is almost impossible to shift out of it, especially if there's strong emotional upset. Because when we're not emotionally triggered, it's easy to have these conversations. It's easy to have an intellectual conversation when you're not emotionally invested in the conversation. But the moment it triggers, your hands start sweating a little bit. You start reflecting on your personal experiences and how someone, you share your personal experience and someone in your mind doesn't validate that that's your experience and that it's real. We instantly shut down. and revert to autopilot. And there are cues when it happens. Physical cues. We get a feeling in our stomach. Our heart rate starts to increase, right? We start sweating. We change our posture, i.e. our arms are folded, right? There are certain verbal cues that we use that we otherwise don't use. But when we're triggered, we go to them. Does that make sense? And if we become aware of when that's happening, we can start figuring out a way how to navigate through that so we can actually have the conversation that we intend to have. And that's what bias does. That's the impact of bias unchecked. Okay. So we already talked about this bias. Oh, okay. So here we go. So I need this table and these tables and this table. You two here. I want you to close your eyes. Okay? I just want you to listen to what's being played. Everybody else, I want you to watch. Okay? So close your eyes.
Ba 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 ba.
Okay, open your eyes. What did you hear?
Ba
ba. People who were watching, what did you hear?
Da da.
Da da. So those of you who were watching, close your eyes. Those of you who had your eyes closed, I want you to watch and I want you to hear.
Ba ba. Ba 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 ba.
What'd you hear?
Ba ba.
What'd you hear? Okay, so we should be hearing the same thing. What'd you hear?
Ga
ga. Okay. You didn't hear ba ba though, right?
Not with my eyes open. I heard ga ga.
Okay. So we're gonna watch it together because some of you are thinking this guy's not showing me the same video. But I am. Okay, I promise. Okay, so here we go. We're gonna watch it together.
Ba 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 ba.
And we heard.
Ba ba.
Okay, everybody, close your eyes.
Ba 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 ba.
And you heard.
Ba.
This is called the McGurk effect. It illustrates how our senses don't always work well together. Right? We actually listen with our eyes. So when we're watching it, we're not actually listening to what he's saying, we're watching what he enunciates.
Ba ba, ba ba.
It's only when we close our eyes and we remove that visual sensory that we're actually able to hear the audio, which is da ba ba. So they record him saying ga ga. Ga ga is what he's enunciating. But the audio you hear is da da. Ba ba, sorry, ba ba. Excuse me, and I don't mean the confusion. Baba, do you see how that works?
Does that mean we
collect it? I'm going to interject.
Say it again.
There are some of us people are able to read lips.
Something, yes.
So if you read lips,
yes.
It comes out differently.
But that's a learned behavior, right? That's a learned skill. Not all of us have that.
So what you're saying is that they
record them saying one thing, and then loop the audio over top of it.
Or he didn't say the same.
So when we had
he didn't
loss.
Say the same thing. Yes. He did not. So this is how our. Remember when I said earlier that our brain can go without making meaning? And this is a great example, right? Because I can't see something and hear something different. That's what our brain is telling us right now. But the reality of it is that's true.
It's true.
We hear with our eyes. We're watching how the person is saying the words. Our brain is anticipating what they're about to say, which we interpret as listening. But we're actually watching how they say the words. Yes.
We didn't hear that back.
Intersensory conflict. This just goes to show again how our brain works well most of the time.
Look at people when they're talking.
Yes. Does that make sense to everybody? And again, this is why it's important to have self-awareness. And this is how bias impacts us. We're on autopilot, someone says or does something, and we're instantly trying to interpret it based on a limited frame. Yeah. And it's different. This is not a very accessible presentation, which I'm very sensitive about right now. Okay. So find a mistake on the screen. Raise your hand when you found it. Well, I think you had a head start. You can. Okay, I'll help the rest of you. So, how'd you find it so quickly?
Reading it.
Yeah. How many of you went straight to the numbers? Here's why I primed you. I told you, find a mistake on the screen. Right?
It's the last word.
And so instantly, some of you skimmed that a little bit. It was like, oh, I got that. I don't need that. That's what your brain was telling you. And so it instantly went to where you said, something's up. There's multiple colors. They're alternating colors. They're numbers, not words. It must be there. And you spent 2 minutes trying to figure out what was wrong. Yes?
The mistake is actually the bottom line. You said, yes. Find the mistake.
Oh. Shoot.
That's nice.
I'm going to have to use that. Okay. Do you see how that works? How our brains are trying to work very quickly and not necessarily getting it right? This is why. Our brain ultimately makes sense of things through this lens. Again, our brain is a meaning-making machine. It's a living computer. It's framed through our personal circumstances, our age, gender, race, personal experience, education, sexual orientation. All those things frame how we are going to utilize our brain. Fast brain is the Manila voters. That's that commute from to your regular places. The autopilot. The slow brain is where you do strategic thinking and critical thought. Does that make sense? There was a great article in US News that asked 100 CEOs how they use their weekends. It was to catch up and long-term plan or strategic plan. Why do you think they can't do that during the week?
They don't have time.
Everything's going too fast, right? The trick to mitigating bias is forcing yourself into a more utilizing your slow brain. Slowing down, creating intentional pause to ask, say more about that. Here's why I say more about that. One, I know I've been triggered. Someone has said or done something that has hit me, that I felt, right? So I need, one, time and space to really get myself together. Two, I want them to restate what I think I thought they heard, or I heard. Does that make sense? I want to make sure what I thought I heard. And here's the second trick. I want them to hear a second time what they said. Because how many of us actually, when we say something, we don't hear it the way it landed. But when we say it again, what do we tend to do? Slow down, and we self-edit.
What if the person already has the slow brain process?
Well, then they're already there.
Well, I think we better let the rest of society know about that.
True. But does that make sense? And what that does, it creates that intentional space where you're allowing things to slow down. Right? And so often, I just had a conversation today. Someone walked up to me and said, my department feels like Jim Crow America. My first reaction was, oh my God, tell me about it. It was, tell me more about that. My department, here's what's happening. And they got very explicit into their details. And it helped me be able to actually navigate that conversation instead of having an emotional reaction, which most of you would understand why I would, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As opposed to someone just simply saying, like, you know, my colleague who happens to be our HR officer who would hear that and would instantly get emotional, oh my God, we have to fire someone. Okay, let's hear what they're saying. Does that make sense to everybody? But typically when we hear those things, we instantly get an emotional reaction. And instead of actually pausing to let that, to ride that wave, we act in that emotion. Sometimes people don't know what they don't know. Is that a fair statement? And if I can't hold someone accountable if they don't know what they don't know. Does that make sense? Once you know, and I know you know, then we can have some conversations about accountability. But when we talk about things like institutional racism or institutional bias, if they don't know what they don't know, how can they actually help us address it? Does that make sense? Especially if they're not personally impacted by it. One of the first conversations that I had with our HR officer, who happens to be a woman, was creating transgender guidelines for our caregivers. Meaning, someone has self-identified as a transgender male or female, and they are deciding to transition at work, meaning they are going to come, the crude and wrong analogy is they leave work on Friday as Mike, they come to work on Monday as Michelle. Does that make sense? That's the simplest way I can put it. Ultimately, the conversation was, what responsibility does the employer have to help this caregiver in that transition, if any at all? Could we all agree that we do have a responsibility in there? Yeah? So we created guidelines, right, to help managers figure out exactly where and how the process is. It's not a two-day process, just FYI, in case you were wondering. It's not that easy. And here's the comment that they made. This is someone that I know and trust. They said these words. I never thought that we'd have to have this conversation in the workplace. And then I reminded myself, you know, about 50 years ago, the guys were sitting around this table, and they were talking about helping women transition into leadership roles. You know what they said? I never thought I'd have to have this conversation in the workplace. Is that a false statement or a true statement? Do you see how their privilege revealed themselves? And instead of attacking and saying, what do you mean by that? That's so anti, and laying into them, I reminded them of their otherness. And not too long ago, there was a conversation about how to successfully transition people who look like them in a role that we as an employer had in that process. Do you think the conversation shifted? Absolutely. Now, did I change their beliefs? Did I change how they felt about someone who was transgender? Absolutely not. But I changed and I brought attention the institutional impact of implicit bias on our caregivers. And it was a 5-minute conversation. Does that make sense? It happens all the time. But I cannot tell you that I wasn't upset when they said it. My first reaction was, how could they not get this? Healthcare is like education, like 70-30 female to male, until you get to where? The top. Then it almost literally flips on its head. I am like most people in America. I can count on one hand how many male teachers I had before college. Yeah? I can also count on one hand how many female principals I had or superintendents that I know of. He's shaking his head like, I can't think of one. Right?
If you go to Catholic schools, you got the nuns.
Context matters. Right? Does that make sense? Same thing in healthcare. We are a physician-led institution. 75% of our workforce are females. 75%. But when you look at our CEOs, presidents, etc., there are this many female presidents in our institution. Out of 56,000 employees, we have about 75 presidents or vice presidents or et cetera. This many are presidents, this many hold our C-suite role. But we're 75% women. Some of you are like, of course. That makes sense? Yeah? And so when I point that out to our decision makers, they're thinking, really? How could that be? Yes, how can that be? Because it's not a pool problem. It is not a pool. We have plenty to choose from. So let's have a conversation about our processes. And here's where the socialized bias. Do we have caregivers who are women who are self-selecting themselves out of certain roles? Do we have people who self-select not to apply for certain leadership roles? There's great research around how women and men approach recruitment or job searches. On average, a guy looks at it, and I'm just using very general words, a guy looks at a job description and sees like 51% he's applying for the job. Generally speaking, women look for that 85-90% match before they apply for a job. They say, well, I'm not qualified. You got like 7 out of 10 qualifications. Go for it. No, they're not gonna pick me. I need more. Yes, and that guy who gets 51% or 50% of the qualifications, he's gonna narrow and describe him as a real go-getter. He has real potential. You see where this goes? Yeah? And there, someone at that table is going to say, but he only meets half the requirements. Yeah, but we can train the rest.
Right. In fact, it is a little bit of training.
Right?
Exactly.
I didn't hear that. I don't think I want it.
Okay, there's a company here in the area, and this personnel person told my daughter, don't even think going up past that door.
Uh-huh.
That's for men only. She left that company.
Obviously, right? Because, again, it's critically important we recognize and have a level of sense of self-awareness. Because we often, you know that whole adage like a self-fulfilling prophecy? Well, here's the reality of it. We all have different intent. And we're all tuned in to different frequencies. Because of my experience as a black male in America, as an oldest child, as a first-generation college student, as a teen dad, as et cetera, go on and on and on, I am in tune with certain things. Right? I see things that some people don't. I don't wear hoodies. And my colleagues bought me a hoodie for my birthday last year. Right? My fraternity brothers bought me a hoodie for my birthday. Right? They're still wondering, Dre, why don't I see you in that hoodie we bought you? Here's what I explained to them. When I was 16 years old, I was walking down 105 of St. Clair in Cleveland, Ohio, my own neighborhood, and I was surrounded by two police cars because I was walking down the street with my hood on in November going to the corner store. They stopped me, asked me questions. I answered them. I went around my way. But we know that's not always frequently the case. That one experience, I was 16, over 20 years ago, and it's still impacting how I make decisions about what I wear. I lived in Iowa for 10 years. I stood out. I usually wear bow ties, and so it's usually the bow tie that makes sense. When I went to the grocery store with my kids, what do you think people said when they saw me and my kids? You're a brave dad. Your wife is so lucky to have you. Look at you, out with your kids. That's so awesome. Doing a grocery shop, you know, nice. I was getting showered with compliments, right? My wife hated going to the grocery store with our kids. Hated it. And I was like, why don't you just go? It's no big deal. Limited perspective. No, when I went, it was no problem.
She didn't ask you for
everything? Okay. I don't negotiate. So, my kids, they know. And so, here's why my wife hated going to the grocery store. Again, Dubuque, Iowa, northeast Iowa. Anyone who typically looks like me is assumed to be from the south side of Chicago, on welfare, receiving public housing, with multiple kids, multiple baby daddies. And that's typically how they describe my wife when she went to the grocery store. People would volunteer their opinion. They would whisper loud enough for her to hear. Look at her out here. Where's the father? I bet she doesn't even know where the father is. A clerk actually chased my wife down when she took us a cart. You know the carts that look like fire trucks and everything? Told her, stopped her at the door. You can't take that outside the door, outside the store. As another woman who didn't look like my wife, took out the... You see how that works? But I couldn't believe it because I didn't experience it. And she's my wife.
Now, when she told me the cart story, so what they didn't know is I worked for the city manager. Right? So I had a little privilege. I knew the owner of said store, and guess what happened the next day? We had a little conversation about how profiling impacts their customers. Right? That didn't happen again. Not just to happen to my wife, but it didn't happen to other people too. But I had a privilege, I had positional privilege where I could have that conversation. I walked in my nice suit bow tie with the city manager and the mayor. And we had a nice little conversation. Does that make sense? That's what bias looks like. It's shaped through our lenses, our experience. These are some types of bias that tend to happen, that often are couched into a lot of decisions that we're making. And we've seen these before. Availability bias, we rely on information that's available to us. This is when we hear those things like, I just want qualified candidates. Right? I just want the best person for the job. Who doesn't? Right? Right? But if we only look at the people who come to us, or I'm not a fisherman, but there's that analogy of you have to cast a wide net. There's recency bias. I often have this conversation with folks. And I use the workplace analogy because to make it easier. If you fire someone, you know someone who was fired at your job, and you couldn't stand it. And then the next person who was replacing that person reminds you of that person that just got canned or that you couldn't stand. What's the likelihood of you're going to give that new person the benefit of the doubt? You see how that works? So if things happen, I don't know, a little boy is shot with a pellet gun in a park. Or with a can of, you know, tea and Skittles in his pocket with his hood, walking in his neighborhood. Or you just got pulled over in your own neighborhood and you were just going home. And then all of a sudden you get clammed up when you see the police and your friend who's sitting next to you doesn't look like you. And they ask that question, dude, what's wrong? You weren't doing anything. Does that make sense? Or that boss who was a little too friendly. Right? Who says things like, well, you know, if you just had more experience. Recency. If it happens recent, is it a surprise that it's going to stick with you? Of course not. Then it's my favorite, confirmation bias. This is when, you know, something happens and we're like, see, I told you. Is that person who was hired that you didn't think should get hired, and the first time they screw up, what do you say?
I told you so.
I told you. Right? It's that kid in the college classroom who happens to be about 6'3", may look like he can jump or run or something, and then he walks around with a jersey on, and they say, see, I told you. Yes?
That's like if a person with a disability,
yes,
is hired, but then they, you're not multiple tasks.
Yes. Or you put them as a greeter.
Oh, yeah.
You see how that works? We see things, and then when that person fits into our nice little bubble, we look at that confirmation bias. And then there's that affinity bias. It's that person, if they look like us, or we relate to them, we tend to gravitate towards them, right? I used to have a manager who liked to hire people after he said these words. This person reminds me of me when I was at this stage in my career. There's a nursing department where it seems like if your name's not Mary, dash something, you're not qualified to work on that floor. It's like Mary Ann, Mary Smith, Mary Beth, Mary Sue.
Mary Louise.
Right? There's a residence department, our ortho department. All of them look like they are Abercrombie and Fitch models. Like there's like they all went to modeling school but decided that's not going to work. So they're going to be orthopedic surgeons. I mean, they're all like gorgeous. I'm like, where is, and they're all guys. There's one female ortho resident. And whenever we have conversations, she's like, you have no idea the conversations I hear. And when I talk to the chair, I'm like, why does everyone look the same? And this is what he tells me. I hire people who I think will be successful. And we all do it. Okay. So here are some things that we can do. And I've mentioned these things over and over again. We have to recognize that bias exists. Bias exists, and it's real. Bias in and of itself is neither good nor bad. It's the impact of bias that has a negative or positive impact. Meaning, if we don't recognize that we have bias, and we just simply operate and make decisions based on that bias that's unchecked, that's when we create those negative impacts. We have that disparate impact, as my government friends like to say. And we've seen these things happen before. If we look at housing lending practices. Has everyone heard of redlining?
Oh.
Yeah? Bankers literally drew a red line on the map and said if you have a certain hue in your skin, you couldn't live past here. That was accepted practice. Guess what? Even though that's not illegal, they still use that methodology. It's trained into realtors and how they make decisions and all that fun stuff. If we don't recognize the impact of unchecked bias, how can we have institutional change? Translation, when I was working in the city of Dubuque, one of my jobs was to look at our selection process for police officers. Long story short, we completely changed it after I had one simple conversation. I asked the chief, I said, describe an ideal police candidate for me. What's a qualified candidate? He said, look, I need somebody who's about, you know, who's not right out of high school or right out of college, who's lived a little bit, who's responsible, who understands that they're going to work nights and weekends and miss birthdays, that they can talk to people cold, and they can just relate to people, that they can understand that they can talk their way out of a situation faster than they can force themselves out of a situation. It's like, oh, that sounds like a great guy. And I asked a simple question. Does our selection process allow folks to show those qualifications? What do you think his answer was?
No.
Well, we interview them. Yeah, but what are the questions you're asking? What's the process? And he said, well, we have this AKA test. It's called the post test. We have the civil service law that we have to abide by. I said, okay, great. What's the civil service law minimum requirement? 70%. Okay, 70%. Why are we only interviewing people who score a 97 or better? Well, we only have the capacity to interview about 70 people of the 260 or so folks that apply annually. And we just pick an arbitrary number that gives us that 70 number. So we're not even interviewing everyone who's qualified? No. Okay. So here's what we're going to do. We completely changed it. We have can measure how well do you respond on the spot. At our physical agility and post tests, we had community members, NAACP, the Urban League, we had our immigration our department, we had city staff, we had people who these people were going to interact with that were not police, walking around, interacting with them. And we were gauging how well they interacted with people who weren't, who we knew, they knew, were police officers. And all the other officers, because the police officers had nice t-shirts on, caps, or were a uniform. And if we noticed the candidate only making contact with the officer, we gave him a deduction, or her a deduction. Right? That was part of their evaluation process. When they went to the panel, we had a citizen, police officer, city official, and a community advocate. Those were our four initial panelists. They selected who got to meet with the actual, with the chief, assistant chief, and myself. Does that make sense? And so what we found was people scored like 99, 98, still made it through the process. But we started hiring people who were in that 88, 89, 90. And lo and behold, we started seeing more people of color. More people who were openly gay. More people who were in between that 25 and 30 range. Right? We hired our two first black police officers after 1 year of doing the selection process, who made it through the field training program. Because we had other black candidates, but they never made it through the field training program. We have more women. Does that make sense? You can't get what you're not, you can't say this is what I want and not measure for. Right? Here's the other thing. We made mandatory promotion a police community dialogue on race. 6 weeks of intentional conversations about how race impacts police officers and their interactions with citizens. Mandatory 6 week conversation if you wanted to get promoted. If you didn't want to get promoted, you could avoid it. But who doesn't want to get promoted? And we made our community policing unit a promotion position. A lot of places, that's kind of like where you just throw your entry-level people. That was promotion. That was a promoted position. They're all corporals or better, captains, lieutenants, etc. Does that make sense? We changed the scope of how folks looked at the impact of that because we recognized those things. Yes?
Question. So the process you just described with how the candidates interact with other people, does that replace the psychological part of the exam? Because that's where I find a lot of people who are qualified, how they disqualify them. They'll say, oh, you didn't pass the psych exam. No. I'm the most sane person in there. You know,
we eliminated that psychometric tool. Mm-hmm. We didn't use any other assessment tool that couldn't be validated. The post test was required because it went through a rigorous selection process through the state. But those psycho tools that a lot of folks use, those aren't actually validated tests. Right? Like Myers-Briggs, as much as I like Myers-Briggs, it should not be used for selection processes. Does that make sense? And so we just made sure that we're actually measuring for what we're looking for. And so this is my favorite slide, and this is the last one I have before we start asking questions. I think I'm way over, but Dr. Bolivar, so it's, yeah. Oftentimes this is how we, the attitude most of us have. This is not my job. If it doesn't impact me, why should I care? And this is what we tend to end up with. This is not a picture from the city of Dubuque. these are not my people. Okay? But we can't have this attitude. We have to create that intentional space so that we can be able to truly mitigate our bodies. So as you're having that conversation next week, and someone says something that really kind of rubs you the wrong way, pay attention to those cues that you're feeling, right? Don't just ignore the fact that it hits you. Be curious about it. And then create a pause. You don't necessarily have to cue to take my phrase, say more about that. But ask a question. I often say things like this. Here's what I heard you say. Is that what you said? If it is, here's how I interpreted what you said to me. Right? It creates that space. Because if what I think I heard them say is not what they actually meant to say, then now we can have a dialogue about what it is that they're actually trying to say. Right? Instead of like, you know, I lose a lot of arguments because here's what my wife tends to say. I don't know what you meant to say. I know what you said. We can't, if we truly want to have a conversation around equity and inclusion, that can't be our posture. It can't be. So I had a friend who, and this is the last story I will share with you, president of NAACP in Dubuque, he has this great analogy when it comes to conversations around race between black and white people. White people are entering the conversation trying to prove that they're not racist. The black person is waiting to see and hear when they prove that they're racist. Right? It's kind of like I'm waiting. It's like that double edge. Like, yeah, they're going to say it. Gotcha! And that's when it counts. That's when they engage in a conversation. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And it's true. If we really genuinely think about it, around these conversations, we're waiting for that moment where someone validates what we think we already know. And we're not really creating space to actually have that critical conversation. Because I can validate your experience as in that it's real without agreement. Validation does not mean I have to agree with you. It just simply means I have to acknowledge your experience is real. And most of us, I have a friend who happens to be white. He and I have conversations that I make sure I tell him at the end and beginning of most of those conversations. Don't say anything you're saying to me right now to any other person who looks like me. Because they don't love you like I do. They don't know you like I do. And so you might say something or ask a question that is completely, that might get you hurt. Right? And so when we're having those conversations, we can unpack it. Right? How wonderful would it be if we could have those friend conversations where someone can simply say, I appreciate your experience. I validate that it's real, not necessarily in that neat package, but I can't get there. Most of us will give that person the benefit of the doubt. Who I can give the benefit of the doubt to is the person that just simply refuses to acknowledge that my experience is real. That's where we often lose. That's where most of us lose credibility. I use my wife as an example a lot, but if my wife simply, she tried her best, and I often ask what it's like to give birth, and she goes in all these details, and my response is, you know what, that's nice and all, but you know what, it doesn't really matter. We're both parents. Walking away knowing that person at least It validated that my experience is real. And I, because the real conflict in most of these conversations is that we are debating the validity of our own lived experience. That's really the root cause of the conflict. That me, as a person of color, or a young person, I have to defend my experience. I spend more time defending that what I experience is real and not some illusion that I made up on my own. That we're no longer talking about how we can create equitable institutions and inclusive environments. We're talking about me. Because you can't even agree that my experience is real. If you can't agree that my experience is real, how are we going to actually be able to resolve it? Thank you for your time.